said, my heart at ease, gonna make a sentimental journey to relive old memories. Got my bag, got my reservations, spent each dime I could afford. Like a child in wild anticipation, longed to hear that all aboard. 7, that's the time we leave at 7. I'll be waiting up for heaven, counting every mile of railroad drag that takes me back. Never knew my heart could be so yearning. Why did I decide to roam? But I've got to take this sentimental journey, sentimental journey home, sentimental journey home, sentimental journey home. Thank you all. Now, first of all, has everybody got their seat turned so they can see? I don't want anybody having to crane around and get a crick in their neck or anything like that, you know? So I want to thank you all for coming tonight, and thank Larry and Joyce for having me here, and also just allowing me to share some of my favorite songs and dances and theater stories. As Mike said, he used a lot of my material already. He said that I grew up in Grove, University of Tulsa, New York, and then had a nice career on Broadway throughout the country and around the world. But back in high school, I used to listen to some of the same singers that my parents listened to, like, Bing Crosby, Frank Sinatra, Dean Martin, and I thought, you know, I was born in the wrong era. I could have been a pruner. Well, tonight, maybe I'll do a little pruning for you. And I'll follow in the right footsteps in his very shoes. These are his spectators, circa 1955. Not bad, huh? just like some of the other printers wore, too, you know. Now, I am going to ask you to work with me tonight. If you happen to hear a song that's a favorite of yours or one that brings back a warm memory, just go with it. If you like it, close your eyes and let that music just waft over you, okay? And don't worry, I'll still be here when you wake up. Open your eyes. I remember doing a show for Rotary Club in Grove, and I looked over, sure enough, two gentlemen had their eyes closed. And I thought, well, either they're really into the music, or they just had a nice lunch, and I had to take a little nap. Either way, I was fine with it. So, but now let's address the obvious thing here. We're here. You're here, I'm here, we're here. But, as Mike mentioned, there's something that isn't here. There are no instruments. Now, it's all a cappella, and I went online to see if I could find an instance of another performer doing an entire show a cappella. And I couldn't. I could find individual songs on YouTube that were a cappella, and I could also find a cappella groups doing a whole show. But no one person doing the whole show. So I thought, well, somebody must know something that I don't know. You know, and I shouldn't be doing this, but whatever. Welcome to my grand adventure. Thank you. When I began to look for material last summer for the show, when I put it together, I knew I wanted to have something by one of America's premier songwriters, Irving Berlin. But in researching him, I found that he had a very ill-kept secret. He couldn't read music, and he couldn't write music, and he could only play in the key of F sharp, because that hit all the black notes. However, he had an ace up his sleeve. He had a piano with a transposing keyboard. There was a little lever over here, he shoved it over, and the hammers had a different set of strings. There's actually a YouTube video of his playing that. It's incredible. So, he would compose a song in his head, sit down at his piano, select the key, sing it and play it, and someone else would write it down. So, it worked for him. Now, in 1926, he wrote Always as a wedding present for his wife. When it gets better than that. He also gave her the royalties to the song for life. Now, ladies, that's a wedding present. Yeah. Then, in 1935, he wrote Dancing Cheek to Cheek, for Fred Astaire in the movie Top Hat. Now, interestingly enough, Fred Astaire didn't think he was much of a singer. He didn't think of himself that way. I beg to differ, because over his long career on stage and in film, he introduced 134 new songs to the public. So in my eyes, he's a pretty darn good singer. So here I'm going to put together Always and Dancing Cheek to Cheek. Maestro, may I have a B flat, please?
I'll be loving you always with a love that's true always. When the things you've planned need a helping hand, I will understand always, always. Days may not be fair always. That's when I'll be there always. Not for just an hour, not for just a day, not for just a year, but always. Heaven, I'm in heaven, and my heart beats so that I can hardly speak, and I seem to find the happiness I seek when we're out together dancing cheek to cheek. Heaven, I'm in heaven, and the cares that hung around me through the week seem to vanish like a gambler's lucky streak when we're out together dancing cheek to cheek. Oh, I love to climb a mountain and to scale the highest peak, but it doesn't thrill me half as much as dancing cheek to cheek. Oh, I love to go out fishing in a river or a creek, but I don't enjoy it half as much as dancing cheek to cheek. Dance with me, I want my arms about you, those charms about you will carry me through to heaven. I'm in heaven, and my heart beats so that I can hardly speak, and I seem to find the happiness I seek when we're out together dancing, out together dancing, out together dancing cheek to cheek.
Thank you. Now, one of my favorite composers is Jerome Kern. He had his first hit in 1913 with They Didn't Believe Me from his show Girl from Utah. Now, this is an important song in musical theater history because it was the first time that a love song had been written for a show that used everyday language. Before that time, it was like the operetta format of very flowery type prose. So that was important. Now, in my history book club, I was reading a book about Harry Truman, and there was an anecdote in there that's very apropos, I have to tell you. Okay. In grade school, Harry Truman decided that Bessie Wallace was the girl for him. He didn't have much luck. She was the most popular girl in class, and he was that little kid with thick glasses. However, he persevered all through school, and he dated Bessie for 9 years after school. And on one of those dates, he took her to Omaha, Nebraska to see a live stage production of Girl from Utah. And, now I made this next part up. Harry held Bessie's hand as the leading man sang.
And when I told them how beautiful you are, they didn't believe me. They didn't believe me. Your lips, your eyes, your cheeks, your hair are in a class beyond compare. You're the loveliest girl that one could see. And when I tell them, and I certainly am going to tell them, that I'm the man whose wife one day you'll be, they'll never You've chosen me, that from this great big world, you've chosen me.
And that is how Harry won best, I believe. In 1995, I left show business, went to work in corporate America, and stopped singing altogether. Didn't sing in the car, didn't sing in the shower, nothing. And all my friends said, oh, this is just a phase you're going through. We know you. You'll sing again. We know you. You just love it too much. Nope. Been there, done that, over and out. Fini, kaput. Well, haven't I had a little crow in that one? About 7 years ago, when I turned 68, I started singing again. You can do the math. And now you can't shut me up. But one of my real joys, as Mike mentioned, is to sing our national anthem around the area. And I have all the events listed on my website, ronaldyoungentertainer.com. And the total is now a little bit more than you thought, Mike. It's now, drum roll, 79. Thank you. And I had my goal set on 100, and when I hit that 100, Joyce and Larry, you're going to help me throw 100 bats, aren't you? Yeah. We don't know what's going to be, but we're going to throw it. So, anyway, now, also, in the late 70s, I took a little time off from performing, and I wrote songs myself, music and lyrics. And it didn't get a whole lot of play, but I learned a lot. So I was thinking about this. Tonight, this is my show. My songs. How about if I sing one for you? I was hoping you'd say yes. Oklahoma Man, you'll find slightly autobiographical, but it does tell you how much I love being back here in Oklahoma, okay?
I'm just an old farm boy from the country. Used to walk with my grandpa through the woods. And the granny always baked a lot, those apricot fried pies. I'd sneak a few, but she never, ever got me with the goods. Oklahoma, Oklahoma, how I love to sing this heartland lullaby. Oklahoma, Oklahoma, that's the place where I was born and where I'll die. I packed my bags and left for the big city, and everybody said that I'd go far. But there's an awful lot of big fish from little bitty ponds. Surprise, surprise, I've come back home where my friends and family are. Oklahoma, Oklahoma, how I love to sing this heartland lullaby. Oklahoma, Oklahoma, that's the place where I was born and where I'll die. It's green, green country that I dream of, with rolling hills and many silver lakes. And the people are so friendly, it makes you want to smile. They'll serve you southern comfort and great big T-bone steaks. Oklahoma, Oklahoma, how I love to sing this heartland lullaby. Oklahoma, Oklahoma, that's the place where I was born and where I'll die. That's the place where I was born and where I'll die.
On this, but can we get any lights out here for this next number? This is a little here and then I'm in the middle. Ah, yeah, that's what I need, a little bit more. Ah, good, that's it, okay. Oh, what a nice cruise. Okay, now, as long as we're in a down-home mood, this next song, Chickie, was written by a friend of mine from Hominy, Oklahoma, named Willard Beckett. For his show, Lucky Guy, which opened in New York in 2000, 11, off Broadway at the Little Shepherd Theatre. Now, Willard is a very talented man. He wrote the music. He wrote the lyrics. He wrote the book for the show. He directed the show, and he produced the show. He worked on the show for almost 30 years. So, talk about following your dreams. My man Willard did it in spades. So here we have a great play on words, Chicken. In the fair and stormy weather, we're just two birds of a feather. Dare I hope to think of whether we might flock together. Oh, Chickie, tell me do. Oh, Chickie, it's up to you. You're exactly what I've needed so long. My plucky little plucker. Oh, Chickie, you're so fine. Won't you say that you'll be mine? Oh, Chickie, let me sticky closer to you. We'll build a little nest far away from all the rest. A life will be the best. My honey, you're supreme. A Colonel Sanders dream. Oh, Chickie, give a hint. Tell me if I'll be the gent. Oh, Chickie, let me sticky closer to you. Oh, Chickie, just one smile will make my life worthwhile. Nonetheless, I confess, you're a foul obsession with me. Oh, you make me want to pull it. Oh, Chickie, understand that you're my one bird in the hand. Oh, Chickie, let me stick you closer to you, to you, to you, to you. I'll carry you away to that loveland where we'll stay while the sun shines, we'll make hay. Hey, hey, oh, please come out and play. I'm looking for a lady, Chickie. Tell me if I'll be the gem. Oh, Chickie, let me sticky closer to you. Well, I can't sleep from dusk till dawn, cause I'm over like you begging me on. I'm acting like a turkey hunter, quite right along. You're driving me insane, you've sun in front of my brain. Oh, Chickie, give a hint. Tell me if Bobby the gent. Oh, Chickie, let me sticky closer to. You'll never get arrested just for being double breasted. Chickie, let me sticky closer to you. Cluck, cluck. Isn't that fun? Okay. Now, I've never been onto Ancestry.com, but I have a feeling that I'm basically hash with a little Irish thrown in, because I like Irish songs. There, okay. Now, I'm going to put three Irish songs together. The first one is by that famous Irish Catholic from Providence, Rhode Island, George M. Cohan. Also known as the man who owned Broadway and the father of musical comedy. Now, for his show, 45 Minutes from Broadway, he wrote Mary for the big star of the day, Faye Templeton. Now, Dr. Arthur Callahan was a resident of Galway, Ireland, and he wrote Galway Bay, which was become almost an anthem for the area. And there are a few words in there that might be unfamiliar to you. One is Clada. That's a town on Galway Bay. Then the barefoot gossans at their play, the barefoot children at their play. The women in the uplands digging praties, digging potatoes. And then the strangers at the land. Now, who would the strangers be in Ireland? The British. Yeah. So, that tells you about Galway Bay. Now, the third song is one of my favorite songs, and I've never sung it on stage until I put it in the show for last summer. Danny Boy. Now, oddly enough, it was written by an Englishman, Fred Weatherly. And when it was released in 1910, it was not successful. Then his sister-in-law, who was Irish, suggested that he redo the lyrics slightly and put it to the Irish folk song Legendary Air. He did. He re-released it in 1913, and it was enormously successful, and largely due to all the Irish fathers having to send their sons off to World War I. So, it was sung at John F. Kennedy's funeral, it was sung at Elvis Presley's funeral, and the tune was played at Princess Di's funeral. So here we have our three sons.
Mary.
And by the way, do we have any Marys in the audience? Do you like any Mary? I know one. Arizona, have you left? There's another one. Okay. This is dedicated to you. And Mary. Then Galway Bay and Danny Boy. Okay?
Oh, it is Mary, Mary, plain as any name can be, but with propriety, society will say, Marie. To hear again the ripple of the trout stream, the women and the men are making hay, and to sit beside a turf fire in the cabin and watch the barefoot gossoons at their play. For the breeze is blowing o'er the sea from Ireland, are perfumed by the heather as they blow. And the women in the uplands dig in praties, speak a language that the strangers do not know. For the strangers came and tried to teach us their ways. They scorned us just for being what we are, but they might as well go chasing after moonbeams or light a penny candle from a star. And if there is going to be a life hereafter, and somehow I'm sure there's going to be, I will ask my God to let me make my heaven in that dear land across the Irish Sea. Danny Boy, the pipes are golden, from glen to glen and down the mountainside. The summer's gone and all the roses fallen. Tis you must go and I must bide. But come ye back when summer's in the meadow, or when the valley's hushed and white with snow. Tis I'll be here in sunshine or in shadow. Oh, Danny Boy, oh, Danny Boy, I love you so. When ye come back and all the flowers are dying, if I am dead, as dead I well may be, you'll come and find the place where I am lying. you tread above me, and all my grave shall warmer, sweeter than me that you love me. And I shall sleep in peace until
I do love that song. But now I think we can use a little change of pace now, don't you? Okay. In 1954, Pablo Beltran Ruiz, I like to say that name. Pablo Beltran Ruiz wrote Quien Será.
When the stress had to sway, Dean Martin had a huge hit with it. Here's to you, Dean.
Thank you. Yeah, I kind of got to get into this a little bit. Okay.
When marimba rhythms start to play, dance with me, make me sway, like a lazy ocean hugs the shore, hold me close, sway me more, like a flower bending in the breeze, bend with me, sway with ease, when we dance you have a way with me, stay with me, sway with me. The dancers may be on the floor, dear, but my eyes can see only you have that magic technique, when we sway I grow weak, I can hear the sound of violins, long before it begins, make me thrill as only you know how, sway me smooth, sway me now. The dancers may be on the floor, dear, but my eyes can see only you have that magic technique, when we sway I grow weak, I can hear the sound of violins, long before it begins, make me thrill as only you know how, sway me smooth, sway me now, sway me smooth, sway me now, sway me smooth, sway me now. Ah.
Well, it's a different mix of music, isn't it, tonight? Now, last fall I was asked to sing at two different weddings, and surprisingly enough, they both requested songs I'd never sung before, Elvis Presley love songs. So I found a third one to go with it, and now I have my tribute to Elvis Presley. And so, the first one is, Can't Help Falling in Love, from his movie Blue Hawaii in 1961. Then he did the lyric for a Civil War tune called Oral Lee, and he had his title song for his 1956 movie Love Me Tender. He then recorded Are You Lonesome Tonight in 1960, and it was the first recording he made after his 2 years stint in the Army. These were all three enormous hits for Elvis, and I like it. So let's see.
Wise men say only fools let him, but I can't help falling in love with you. Shall I stay? Would it be a sin if I can't help falling in love with you? Like a river flows surely to the sea, darling, so it goes. Some things are meant to be. Take my hand, take my whole life too, for I can't help falling in love with you. Love brief tender, love me sweet, never let me go. You have made my life complete, and I love you so. Love me tender, love me true, all my dreams fulfill. For my darling, I love you, and I always will. Love me tender, love me long, take me to your heart, for it's there that I belong, and will never part. Love me tender, love me true, all my dreams fulfill. For my darling, I love you, and I always will. I am lonesome tonight. Do you miss me tonight? Are you sorry we drifted apart? Does your memory stray to a brighter summer day when I kissed you and called you sweetheart? Do the chairs in your parlor seem empty and bare? Do you gaze at your doorstep and picture me there? Is your heart filled with pain? Shall I come back again? Tell me, dear, are you lonesome tonight? Tell me, dear, are you lonesome tonight?
Thank you. Stormy, let's have some more light out here now. Stormy, can we have some more light? Okay, now. Carrie asked me about my favorite song. Are we okay, Randall? Is that good? Okay. You know what's good about doing a show for yourself? You can pick all your favorite songs to sing. It's amazing. Well, okay. When he was a student at Indiana University, Hoagy Carmichael wrote Stardust. 2 years later, Mitchell Parrish put lyrics to that gorgeous melody, and it went on to be one of the most recorded songs of the 20th century, with over 1,500 recordings. And it was a big hit for Bing Crosby, but my favorite recording, which is still on YouTube, is Nat King Cole. Now, how you describe Nat King Cole's voice, I kind of have a way, I think. You take a piece of glass, you pour a little honey on it, you tip that glass, and you watch the honey ooze. To me, that's Nat King Cole's voice. So, here's Stardust. And now the purple dusk of twilight time steals across the meadows of my heart. High up in the sky, the little stars shine, always reminding me that we're apart. You wander down the lane and far away, leaving me a song that will not die. Love is like the stardust of yesterday, the music of the years gone by. Sometimes I wonder why I spend the lonely night dreaming of a song. The melody haunts my reverie, and I am once again with you. When our love was new, and each kiss an inspiration, but that was long ago. Now my consolation is in the stardust of a song. Beside the garden walls, when stars are bright, you are in my arms. A nightingale tells his fairy tale of paradise where roses grew. Though I dream in vain, in my heart it will remain, my stardust melody, the memory of love's refrain. Thank you. Oh, I love that song. Now, we have to have just a little change of...
This is real technical.
Oh, hi. Okay, now. I used to get asked all the time if I was a singer or a dancer or which I liked better. Well, I've just always done both. I like them both. Now, I've been told, I don't remember this, but I've been told that when I was really small and saw my first television show of a musical variety show, that I stood in front of the set the whole time saying, "That's what I want to do, that's what I want to do, yes!" Well, evidently I follow that to the nth degree, haven't I? But you know, haven't I been lucky? All I ever wanted to be was a song and dance man. One way to tell you about it would be to read two pages from my book that Mike mentioned. This book, I'm very proud of it. It's turned out to be more than just a memoir. It's an inspirational book. People are finding that, well, if he could live his dream, I could live my dream. And also said, hey, I gave two copies to the library at school, too. Yeah. So, okay. And so, thank you. And if I read a section in here about my first audition in New York, it'll tell you, but I had to set it up because back in the early 60s, Broadway shows had separate singing choruses and separate dancing choruses. You didn't do both. I didn't know that. Okay, here we go. A dream comes true, New York City. I arrive on a Friday in September of 1963, having arranged to stay with Jimmy Powers, a friend from Summer Stock. Hey, you got here just in time. There's an audition for the role of Barnaby in Hello, Dolly! On Saturday. This is a big new Broadway show directed and choreographed by Gower Champion. Let's go. Gower Champion. Wow. In town one day, and it's off to my first audition. We trooped down the standing line with all the others on Saturday, hoping there was an outside chance we would be cast in the role. I was typed out immediately, too tall. However, it did give me my first chance to feel the sensation of standing on a Broadway stage. Memorable. On the following Monday, the audition for Equity Singers would be held, with dancers being seen on Tuesday. Why not go to both auditions? Only later was I told that in those days, this was very rarely done, if ever. You know, sometimes ignorance is bliss. Monday morning dawned. My choice of what to wear is still very vivid. Black slacks, black blazer, black vest, white shirt with a scotch plaid red tie. We arrived and were given numbers. Mine was up in the hundreds somewhere. My time finally came to step on stage and hand my music to the accompanist to sing 16 bars. My choice of song that day was If Ever I Would Leave You with Camelot, because the last 16 bars had a high G that fit my voice very well. After my audition, Gower asked me to come back the following Monday for the singer's final. Oh boy. Now, the next day was the Equity Dancers call, and here, the green Oklahoma kids stood out a little bit in a strange way. At most dancers' auditions, the dancers wore dance pants or tights with t-shirts or tank tops. I wore the same ensemble from Monday without the blazer, just exchanging the black slacks and black dance pants. Now, whoever in their right mind would wear a shirt and tie to a dance audition? Once again, we were given numbers. When my number was called, Gower looked at me and said, "Did I ask you to come back for the dancers' call today?" "Oh no, Mr. Champion, I just came on my own." The choice of attire worked, he remembered me. Then it was on to the dancing. Ballet was first. Oh no, that wasn't my strong suit. Gower's assistant demonstrated the combination. This was going to be doable. Maybe not the best, but passable, and I remembered. It was glissade, assemblé, glissade, assemblé, second, fourth, double pirouette down, and then reversal. Sure enough, my best was good enough, and I made it past the cut. Then it was on to the tap combination, which was fairly simple for me. At the end of the audition, Gower asked me to return for the dancer's final following Tuesday. On that day, when the last selection came, it was literally like a scene from a later Broadway show, A Chorus Line. All the dancers who had made it past the all-day color process were standing in the line on stage. "Ron, will you come down stage to the front line?" He pulled other dancers down the front as well. Then there was an interminable wait until Gower said, "I would like those in the front to be my dancers. Rehearsals begin in 2 weeks." Wow! I wanted to run down to Times Square screaming, "I just got my first Broadway show!" Now, all that talk about dancing, you want to see a little dancing?
Yeah!
Well, let me see if I could find something down here. Let's see what I have here. Oh, yeah. Oh, what is this? Oh! I don't think they'll give me any Kansas. Now, a lot of you in the audience know Patti Beth Anderson?
Yeah!
What am I done? Okay. When I told her I was going to be changing shoes in my show, she said, "Well, don't look like Mr. Rogers and take all day." So, I took her word at it. And if you could believe me, I've actually practiced this shoe change several times. So now, you can tell that wasn't bad. Okay. Now, I want to take a little mystique out of tap dancing, okay?
No.
Yeah. Basically, we only have two toes, two heels, and we can brush it back and forward at the shuffle, or we can scuff it with a heel, and that's all we have to turn our lower extremities into a percussion instrument. Now, I'm going to show you an exercise I've done for years to help get this as clean as possible, these taps. I do 16 forward and 16 back. I'm going to do it four times. The first time there's going to be two sounds to a beat. The next time there's going to be three sounds to a beat. The next time there'll be three sounds with a different step. And the last time there'll be four sounds to a beat. So here we go. If you want to count 16, you can. I don't count anymore because I know what it is. Come out loud. And back. Keep it as smooth and even as possible. Three. And back. Now I'm going to change it. A different sound. There will be three sounds with a different step. That's a shuffle step. Keep it smooth and even. And back. Now I'm going to four counts by adding a heel drop. Ready? Here we go. How could you applaud if you didn't hear all mess ups? Okay. Dynamics in tap dancing, loud and soft. So you take that three step and you do it soft and then loud. So but they're always keeping it smooth and even. Soft. Loud. Okay, now, I have one of the best tap teachers in New York. It's Paul Draper. You can Google him. He was phenomenal. He gave an exercise that you can do for years. It's basically one step and then repeat it. It's brush, toe, heel, shuffle, step, toe, heel. Then you reverse it. Brush, toe, heel, shuffle, step, toe, heel. You start out doing it slowly and evenly. Pick up the pace just a little bit until you can't do it any faster. So here we're going to start. Here we go. Ready? And. And faster. With variations that I choreographed for this show. You ready? Here we go. Maestro, if you please.
Bum, 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 bum
How about a shout out for my band?
Thank you very much.
Okay. Now, oh, I should have more. Oh, I forgot to tell you a couple of things about the memorabilia before. That collage of my life over there was done by a school friend of mine, Wanda Sager Magoo, no longer with us. And she did a wonderful job on that. And then the picture with Angela Lansbury is back in the back on that side. So, one of the most interesting times in my theater career occurred in the mid-80s. I received a call from Tommy Toon, a friend in the business, and he said that he's going to be starring in a new show with Twiggy called My One and Only. And he wondered if I would be standing by for him. At the same time, I had a call from Alan J. Lerner, who wrote My Fair Lady, offering me a small part in his new show called Dance a Little Closer. So what to do? Dance a Little Closer, My One Only. My One Only. Good choice. Dance a Little Closer closed after a very short run, and I got almost 2.5 years of work on My One Only. Now, Tommy Toon is a very tall Texas legend in show business. He got so tired of people asking him how tall he was, he developed a stock answer. I'm 5'18". It's true, he was 6'6". Okay, so now, Broadway shows go out of town to try out, to work out all the kinks before the New York critics. So, we went to Boston. We got to Boston and discovered that our director had been fired, and Tommy was also hired to direct and co-choreograph as well as to star. And it had a big impact on me because it meant that when he directed, I was on stage doing his part. And then if there were changes for the show that night, I would walk him through them between the rehearsal and the show, and literally walk him through the show. I would take him to his entrance, meet him at his exit, and it's very interesting. But the best part about that was that I got to go to the production meetings. Now, the production meetings were all the creative people, and including the show doctor. Now, a show doctor is somebody who's a friend of the director's, who gets paid very nicely, but no billing. We were fortunate to have that Oscar-winning genius, Mike Nichols, as our show doctor. So going to these production meetings, it was like a master class in theater. I was just like a sponge soaking everything up. So on the road, we were playing, and Tommy had a tap dance duet with Charles Honey, H-O-N-I, Coles, one of the gods of the tap dancing world. It stopped the show cold every night. That being said, we didn't get good reviews. So when we came back to New York, the producers decided, don't open yet, we're gonna go back into rehearsals. So after we went into rehearsals, about a week before the first preview, someone realized that Honey, contractually, was gonna be out of the show to dance with his group, the Copacetics, in California. They began to audition older black tap dancers around New York quickly, and the routine is just a little tricky, so it's terrible. We couldn't learn it that fast. So 4 days before the first preview, Tommy comes in to rehearsal. He says, go home and create a character, because I knew the dance already. So I thought, well, okay, what am I going to do? I'm in my 40s, and not black, and Honey's 70s. So I went home and I worked creating a fantasy character, and I came in. I read with Tommy, and he said, that's it, you're on for Mr. Magic's. So, quickly we went to wardrobe. Honey wore a black tuxedo with sequins, gorgeous, and a tails outfit. And we found a white suit that had been cut from a number in Boston, and I fit it, so I wore the white suit, white fedora, sunglasses, red tie, and these red tap shoes. So, and then Mike Nichols said, put on dark makeup. And I said, no, you can't do that, Mike. It's against equity rules. He said, just put it on. So I found a makeup called Bob Kelly Suntan. I put it on, and evidently it created some fantasy character because I was sitting in my, I had to sit in a barber chair and wait, the stage has to push me on that first performance. I thought, what am I doing? And then a calmness came over me because I thought, I'm a product of all these years of work and I can do this. Well, it was one of the most exciting nights of my career because the audience embraced me, enveloped me. Tommy and I stopped the show with that number again that night, and it was thrilling. But then they made Honey watch me two shows when he came back because he wasn't quite ready to do one. And I thought, what is going through this man's head? Here is his role of a lifetime, and someone else is playing it and getting a good reaction from the audience. So he was cool to be backstage. But then we opened, he got rave reviews, he won the Drama Desk Award and the Tony Award for Best Supporting Actor in a Musical, and we were off and running. 2 months later, we were at a party one night, and he beckoned me over to where he was sitting. And I walked over there, and he said, I saw you up there doing my part, and I thought, that black mother is bad. We were very close. In fact, two things happened that were wonderful. There was a show there in New York called Waiting in the Wings that presented the standbys for the stars of the big shows, doing the big numbers. Honey introduced me to the audience that night. And then on the national tour, I was on for Tommy for a week in Louisville, Kentucky, and my folks came up to see the show, and I took them back to meet him, and he shook my dad's hand and said, sure like dancing with your boy. That's getting better than that. I went on for Honey about 80 times through the run, and Tommy about 30 times. And the title song, My One and Only, was written by George and Ira Gershwin for Fred Astaire in the 1927 production Funny Face. And then they brought it out to use in this show. So it was, come on in. It was, it just has an infectious rhythm to it. So now, I'm going to sing one chorus of the of the song, and then I'm going to go into the tap dance duet. Now, there's a little repetition in it, which is because Honey teaches, when Honey's teaching, I'm going to be facing this way. When Tommy is learning, I'm going to be facing this way. When they're doing it together, I'm going to be facing this way. Now, I don't really expect you to remember that, because I don't remember it all the time either. But this is the song and the number. And my one and only, what am I gonna do if you turn me down when I'm so crazy over you? I'd be so lonely. Where am I gonna go if you turn me down? Why blacken all my skies of blue? I tell you I'm not asking any miracle. It can't be done, it can't be done. I know a clergyman who will grow lyrical and make us one, and make us one soul. My one and only, what am I gonna do if you turn me down when I'm so crazy over you?
Bum 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 b
dancing. Now, I was privileged to star in two productions of this show, opposite Georgia Everett, and you might have seen her recently because she was with the Mary Tyler Moore Show, you know, and the Everybody Loves Raymond. So we did it in two productions, one in Atlantic City at the Ferris Hotel, and then another one at the Big Apple Theater in Kansas City Starlight. So, that was a thrill to do that. Oh, are you having a good time? Okay. Now. I put together three love songs for you. My Funny Valentine. I don't know why. Oh, let me hear it. My Funny Valentine was written by Rodgers and Hart for their show Maids in Arms in 1937. Then I don't know why I just do was a popular song that was very popular in 1931, again in 1946, and again in 1961. Something about a 15-year span there that made it work. So. And then, You Made Me Love You, first recorded by Al Jolson in 1913. Then in 1937, the powers that be at MGM wanted to throw a birthday bash for their biggest star, Clark Gable, and they wanted their newest star, Judy Garland, to sing this song with different lyrics to make her his biggest fan. It was a huge hit, so big that they put it in their next movie, Broadway Melody, in 1938. Then when she released Over the Rainbow as a single, this is side B. That's a little bit too much, isn't it? It's not to do that kind of stuff now. Let me get a little drink of water, then we'll start at the toast. Okay, so here we have My Funny Valentine, I Don't Know Why I Just Do, and You Made Me Love.
You made me love you. I didn't want to do it. I didn't want to do it. You made me want you. And all the time you knew it. I guess you always knew it. You made me happy sometimes. You made me glad. But there were times, dear, you made me feel so bad. You made me sigh, for I didn't want to tell you. I didn't want to tell you. I want some love, that's true. Yes, I do. Indeed, I do. You know I do. Give me, give me, give me, give me what I cry for. You know you got the kind of kisses that I die for. You know you made me love you. Thank you. Now, one more.
This last set
is a tribute to Judy Garland. Now, I have a hook. I have a hook here. In 1968, I was in George M. on Broadway. One evening, the conductor came back before the show, and he looked me up and he said that he was going to be conducting a benefit at Lincoln Center, and they needed some backup singers for some of the stars. Would I be interested? You bet I would. Okay, now, let's cut to the chase. The final star of the evening was Judy Garland, and I got to sing on stage with her in her arrangement of Get Happy. Oh, it's fantastic. But it gets better than that. Then, from out in the wings walks Harold Arlen, who wrote Over the Rainbow with Edgar Hardwick, Judy and the Wizard of Oz. He sits down at the piano. Judy sits down on the edge of the stage, and she sings Over the Rainbow. And when she gets to the end of the song, reaches up her hand to him, says, why can't I? I felt tears streaming down my face. I looked around. Everyone else on stage was in tears. The lady was magic. And that turned out to be her final performance in the United States. It was then that she went to London, and there that she died. So, one more drink of water, and then it's my tribute to Judy Garland. Okay, here we go. Oops. That light did it. It's okay. Forget your troubles, come on, get happy. You better chase all your cares away. Shout hallelujah, come on, get happy. Get ready for the judgment day. The sun is shining, come on, get happy. The Lord is waiting to take your hand. Shout hallelujah, come on, get happy. We're going to the promised land. We're heading across the river. Wash your sins away in the tide. It's all so peaceful on the other side. Forget your troubles and just get happy. You better chase all your cares away. Shout hallelujah, come on, get happy. Get ready for the judgment day. Forget your troubles, come on, get happy. You better chase all your cares away. Shout hallelujah, come on, get happy. Get ready for the judgment day. The sun is shining, come on, get happy. The Lord is waiting to take your hand. Shout hallelujah, come on, get happy. We're going to the promised land. We're heading across the river, wash your sins away in the tide. It's all so peaceful on the other side. Forget your troubles and just get happy. You better chase all your cares away. Shout hallelujah, come on, get happy. Get ready for the judgment day.
Very nice.
when all the world is a hopeless jumble and the raindrops tumble all around, heaven opens a magic lane. When all the clouds darken up the skyway, there's a rainbow highway to be found, leading from your window pane to a place behind the sun, just a step beyond the rain.
And when the night